I was reminded of Peter, you know, silver and gold I have not, none, but take up your mat and walk. I said, no, sorry, we don't have any money, but we're offering spiritual readings and miracles. And what I was, in theory, like what I was saying to her kind of was, we're offering prophetic words and prayer for healing. But it's kind of, I just felt like that was what I should say in that moment. And that kind of opened up kind of an opportunity to speak to her. She was like, whoa. We are walking solutions to people's problems, you know? Everyone's got stuff going on with them, and we are carrying the answer to that. We are carrying the Holy Spirit in us. We are vessels, temples of the creator of the cosmos. And guys, I don't really know what to say other than it's easy. It really is easy. There's a generation now who are rising up with fire in their eyes. And I'm thinking, you know what? I just want to go for this. I don't care if I fail. I don't care if I look stupid. I don't care if people think that, you know, I'm an idiot. I just want to have a go. I just want to see something, you know? I just want to live out like a Christianity that makes sense, like with the way I read the Bible.
You have the authority to release the Holy Spirit. And you have the means to prophetically step up and release someone's healing.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Seeing People Healed on the Streets by Christen, Forster and Dave Jones of River Church, Marlow.
Well, welcome to this part one of Seeing Healing on the Streets of Greenford. Part two is 2 weeks tonight, so if you've not got that in your diary, you might want to do that. And so welcome to Christen. This is Christen. Christen is the main leader of River Church in Marlow. He's going to be leading tonight. He's got Dave with him as well, who I've lost sight of at the moment, but is here somewhere. They're going to be leading tonight, and they'll be back next time with somebody else as well. So I'm just going to hand over to Christen to take us through the evening.
Thank you. Thank you, David. It really is, it's fantastic to be here tonight, and thank you for very much for inviting me. It's going to be a good night. I'll say it confidently. It's actually already been a good night. My prayer for this evening is that there is a tangible, very real release of the goodness of God in a way that raises our hopes, raises our expectations, raises our understanding of who we are in Him. Because actually, all over the world, the Lord is taking His church back to some of the key passages in the New Testament where it challenges us in terms of what we can be on the basis of what Christ has won for us. And He's challenging us as to whether we're really living up to that. And I really want to express that, you see, it's not something you strive after, it's something we rest into. And so sometimes when you stand up and you say things like that, it can be very intimidating. But actually, the truth is Jesus has won it for us. And it is the things in life that entangle us, that make us not fruitful. For the majority of Christian churches, our problem is, in terms of the parable of the sower, is we're not those that the seed fell on hard ground. And we're not those where things have kind of, where we've not fallen away because we're still here. We've not sprung up and gone. We tend to either be those that are producing fruit or those, and unfortunately, I would say this is the majority situation where the fruit has become limited because we're entangled. And I'm just saying it without prejudice and without judgment. It's just the truth. I put my own Christian life, went through huge periods of that. And the funny thing is, it isn't because you're doing anything obviously sinful. It's just the truth that, in fact, sometimes even you're being looked at from the outside and people think you're quite successful. But there isn't, say, that supernatural edge, that spirit-filled edge that you knew when you first met Jesus. Do you remember that time? And there was just, and so we regularly, we find ourselves praying that prayer like David did, restore to me the joy of my salvation, because there was something fresh about when we first came to the Lord, and it was all so straightforward and simple, and people didn't have expectations of us particularly, because it was all so new. You come into church and there are no expectations as to how you behave, because everyone's just thrilled that you've met the Lord and you've become a Christian. But then as you walk with them a bit longer, people start to expect a little bit more of you. And you start to expect a little bit more of ourselves. And so we start to project a little bit more of a persona, because we start to pretend we are what we're supposed to be instead of actually being ourselves in Jesus. And before long, we find ourselves stuck, a bit like Paul describes it to the Galatians. You know, in Galatians 3 and going into 4, he says this. Just want to start with what's positive. Now, faith has come and you're no longer under a tutor. The tutor that Paul is referring to is the law. In fact, in Galatians, he doesn't always call it the law, although our English translation says that. He often just calls it law. Those rules and regulations about how you're supposed to live. You're no longer under that. Because that was like a tutor for you, but now you should be becoming mature, for you're now all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. That's all of you, male and female, you're sons of God. And he goes on and explains it and says, because all of you were baptized into Christ and all of you have clothed yourself with Christ. So whether you are, he goes on, whether you're Jew or Greek, doesn't matter, because you're clothed with Christ. So he was Jewish, so you're clothed with that and you've been born with him in it. Whether you're slave or free, whether you're male or female, all are one in Christ Jesus. We are in him. Not only has he been born in our lives, but also we have been clothed with him. We belong to Christ, we're Abraham's offspring, and we are heirs according to the promise. And that's how we should be. But then he straight away goes on, and now I say to you, as long as an heir is a child, he doesn't differ from a slave, although he's the owner of everything, but he's under guardians and managers until a date set by the father. And he goes on. He says, but because you're sons, God has sent forth his spirit of his son into our hearts that cries out, Abba, Father. So you're not a slave any longer. You're a son. And if you're a son, then you're an heir through God. But in Proverbs, it says the land can't cope with it when a slave becomes a king. Do you know that proverb? The land can't cope with it when a slave becomes a king, because if you take slavery into a position of authority, it doesn't do the job it's supposed to do. And yet that is our very dilemma, that as Christians, as Paul says himself, we are those that have been taken out of slavery and have been made royalty. It is our story. And yet in the flesh, in the natural, that's a disastrous thing to happen. Unless we can live in the Spirit, unless we are clothed with Christ. And you see, when we first get to know Jesus, it's easy to walk in that. I'll tell you some of my own stories. I'd made a commitment to the Lord when I was about 14. I had not been an exemplary child. I won't tell you some of the things because it just takes longer and it gets a laugh normally, but it's not the point of this evening that I used to do. I made a choice at the age of 14. At the age of 15, I was diagnosed with a non-curable, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma right the way through my body. Obviously, if you're kind of quick off the mark, you realise that I survived it, so that's good news. Because I'm not only 16 now. I know you might not believe it, but there you go. And the remarkable thing was, a man came into my room who was a Canadian. His name was Don Northrop. He'd been a paramedic because he wanted to see people healed. He used to go to accidents at the road. And as he went, he came into a charismatic experience, into a Pentecostal experience, and he started, how does this impact my work life? Well, for me, it's obvious because I'm a paramedic. I'll pray for the people that I see on the side of the road. And he started to see smashed up bodies restoring themselves as he prayed over them. He saw two people raised from the dead on the roadside. And so he ended up going around churches, teaching people how to pray for the sick. And as a 15-year-old, he came to our church after I'd been diagnosed. I was there in the hospital. He came in and he prayed for me with the elders. And the next morning, the doctor I was under came in. He was unhappy that I'd been prayed for. And he told my parents it would be easier if you accepted what's going to happen to him than just keep clinging onto these straws. And he came in, he started to examine me, and he just said, he made a joke about it, said, let's exorcise this demon then. And then he started to say, that's interesting. And I said, what's that? And he said, I can't find the lump under your arm anymore. I can't find the swelling. And to cut a long story short, because I don't want to take the time with it, but from that night onwards, they never found a single cell of cancer in my body. But while I didn't know that I was going to be healed, I was in this place of fear. I'd chosen to follow Jesus. And this is what I got. I felt angry. And I felt let down. I had actually done some tough things in my following of Jesus because I had broken some friendships because I couldn't maintain some of the friendships of the things that were going on and we were doing as it was. And I had taken the flak for that. And now here I was being told I was going to die. And in my anger and my fear, I started to monologue at God and shout at him. And, well, maybe not shout, but there was that because, you know, in bed, these cries of anguish went up. But actually, in that place, suddenly the monologue turned into a dialogue. And before I knew I was healed, I knew the love of God. Before I knew I was healed, I knew the love of God. When I realized I was healed, I knew it wasn't just theory. It says, we love because he loved us first. Do you know, it's only the religious spirit that pretends it loves God for no reason. Do you know, it is an absolute con and hypocrisy. If you pretend that you love God because you get nothing out of it, it's just the right thing to do. We love because he's loved us first. Okay? We love, and in evangelism, it's so key to know that. That those you meet on the streets, if they don't love God yet, maybe they have not experienced his love. We know that God loves them. They don't know it. Actually, what we're doing in evangelism, we're looking for the love of God to touch someone. Because why should we expect that they would love God if they don't know that he's loved them first? If we'll take that mentality on, we have a totally different approach to evangelism. And so I knew that God loved me. Because I'd in that place of fear, I had actually engaged with God in a genuine sense for the first time. It wasn't a kind of a fake sort of thing, it was real because I was scared. And now I'd seen something supernatural. I had encountered God, but as well as encountering God, I had actually met what Paul is talking about here is I had met a son of God. You see, the word son is in Greek, it means an adult son, one that's come to maturity, not a child, it's not a male child. It is someone, and that's why he's saying we are all carrying that, because just like the son of God, Jesus, came into his maturity and went about destroying the works of the evil one, we have had him born in us and we have clothed ourselves with him. So whether you're male or female, Jewish or Greek, doesn't really matter because it's him that we've clothed ourselves with and he is the Son of God. And he has come into his maturity. And we can live in that power. It says in Romans where it also talks about being adopted as sons and the same sorts of themes are coming up. It says that if the Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead lives in you, will he not quicken your mortal bodies? Will he not put life in your mortal bodies? Won't he do things in you? Won't there be a dimension of power? Won't there be something of an experience? And here's the weird thing. I went from church to church to church. I go to them, evangelical churches, even charismatic evangelical churches. And time again, we have taken on a lie from the enemy that says it's not about what you feel. You see, it's not in the end about what you feel, but in a relationship, if you never felt anything, it's not much of a relationship, is it? Okay? I don't need to have my wife holding my hand all the time to know that she loves me. But if we never held hands, you would question whether that she loved me, wouldn't you? That makes sense? And what I would say is, as I came out of that experience, having been healed in the hospital, having experienced the love of God before I even knew I was healed, I, as a person, was changed. And for several years, I lived in the courage that experience gave me. I had been the kid at school who was embarrassed about their Christian faith and used to hide it, who was very eager to please because, you know, there were tougher kids than me and all of those sorts of things. And so I'd be eager to please and I would do things and I would get into trouble. And a lot of the stories I could tell you were because I was trying to make a name for myself out of insecurities. And I came back a totally different person. I ended up taking assemblies at school. I ended up praying for people and seeing, at the age of 17, I remember praying for an older guy with a twisted back and one leg was shorter than the other and out popped the leg. Unfortunately, I didn't see it because I had my eyes shut at the time. I always kicked myself on that one. and sharing my faith with friends, and not just with friends, but with my teachers. And then I went to university, and I was still in the enthusiasm of it. And at my university, we saw the CU grow from about 30 folks to over 120 in a college of 1,500. We saw in the formal old chapel that they used to have, we saw people laid out in the spirit on the floor. We saw the sick healed. My wife, as she is now, she wasn't then, had torn ligaments, and her leg was on a crutch. She got prayed for, and she was able to throw the crutch away and take it straight back the next day to the health centre. They couldn't believe what they'd seen, but we saw non-Christians healed. My next-door neighbour was in one of the houses I lived, a student house, was a Greek girl. I remember talking to her about the relationship I had with God, and she said, well, why do you pray? Because I believe in God, but if God knows everything, he knows whether he wants to give it to me or not, so why would praying make any difference? He's not going to change his mind. Next day, she had a really bad toothache, couldn't go to lectures, and I just knew that prompting of the Spirit, and I knocked on her door and said, can I pray with you? And we prayed for her, and I prayed a long prayer, but as soon as I finished, she said, does it always work this quick? Because she was chewing on her tooth, it got healed. But I left university, and I went into Christian ministry, and as the years went by, the supernatural fruit started to dry up. I still had kind of successes, and still I saw God's provision. But it's a bit like what it says about the children of Israel in the desert, where God says to them, I gave you manna, but I kept you hungry, says that in Deuteronomy. That's how I felt. I knew that God was still doing things, but somehow it wasn't like it was. And what I want to share, and I don't want to take too long getting there, because I want to do some other things tonight, is what we have learned over the last few years is that the life that I now live in the Spirit is so qualitatively different from where I was 10 years ago. It's qualitatively different. It's not just a bit more of the same. It is of a total different order. And undermining or underlying everything is the constant deliberate putting myself in the place where I wait for the presence of God. Okay. Those that wait on the Lord renew their strength. I waited patiently. Actually, it's not the word patiently. I waited with intent. I waited with purpose for the Lord. He turned and heard my cry. Jesus says, abide in me and I in you. And if you abide in me and I abide in you, then you ask whatever you will of the Father and it will be done for you. And in that you bear much fruit in this, people will see that you are my disciples and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Isn't that incredible? But what's the context? I'm taking time in Jesus. I'm letting him take time in me. As we have made space for the presence of God, what we find is fruit appears more rather than success. There is a difference between fruit and success. Success you do in the flesh, and people can look at it and say, that's impressive for the Lord. That's impressive for the Lord. But it often makes them feel inadequate and smaller. Or if it doesn't make them feel inadequate and smaller, it often instills in them a competitive streak. I'm going to do something bigger than that and better than that. Okay. And so much of Christian life, I think, is actually driven off that. It's no different from the Tower of Babel. It's actually, if we want to read the whole context of the Galatians story that I was reading, the Galatians passage, it's just a new law. It's a new system of merit. If we keep this and we keep that, then we'll climb up the ladder. And actually, that's in the end what entangles us. And what stops us living in the heirship that we should have in Jesus. Because he's living in us, we've clothed ourselves in him. We have the ability at any moment to step into that. It's not something you have to spend hours and hours earning. But there is something about the way you understand yourself, something about the way you submit yourself, something about the attitudes of heart that allow you to lean into the truth of what Jesus has done for us. Or they keep us standing on our own two feet, going for our own successes. I would say, well, across the church now in River, and it hasn't always been this way, but over the last few years we've been very deliberate in the pursuit of the presence of God and allowing what comes out of that to come out of it. But we see people healed every week. Most of us in leadership now hear the Lord so regularly and on things that seem so trivial sometimes. I don't say this in a competitive way. What I'm trying to get across is there is a different way of living the Christian life. And you see, it comes with this change of mindset. And the change of mindset comes in the place of the presence of God and revelation that comes in. And you just start to find that things happen around you. You start to discover God's favour in the things that you do. And you start to pray for someone and you use a phrase. Just this last week, I'll just give you a couple of examples. So we were praying in one context, and somebody I'd not met before, and we were just in one of those kind of prayer group things, and I started to pray, and I had this phrase, and I just said, I felt the Lord wants to say to you that you've learned to be fruitful, you've learned to speak with your hands, and that's been fruitful, but He wants to give you fruit from your words as well, from your lips. A simplish sort of phrase, didn't think much of it, but it was just definitely what I felt and saw. And she just turns and says, she said, you know, for the last 2 years I've been learning sign language. And it's been really good, really fruitful. I've been saying to the Lord, it's been great, because she does it with these children. She teaches them dance using sign language. She said, but I'm telling the message to their parents, but it's not getting through. And I've been asking the Lord to give me, you know, you've not been asked for a word. It just comes. And praying for somebody else from another church. And because we just doing those things, and I know him very, very vaguely. And just at the end of it, I just said, you know, I just saw you standing outside a derelict shop looking in, and there's a dream in your heart. And he said, we did that 2 days ago. He said, we were just on the high street, there's a derelict shop become available, and we just went and stood outside it, and we were talking about what we could do with it for youth work. Now, I had no word for him other than that, but he went away with a massive sense of the Lord is with me. And those kinds of things happen all the time. And we've seen some remarkable healings. Most of the time, the healings we see seem quite small. But you know what? We thank the Lord for every single one of them. Because, you know, Jesus says, don't despise the day of small beginnings. If you're faithful in the small things, you'll be trusted with much. You know, so we regularly see people with back issues healed and with leg issues healed. But every now and again, we see something remarkable. We had a lady started coming. She'd been having treatment for breast cancer, and she met. There was a Christian mum that she used to meet at the school gate, and then she met another Christian lady who was getting treatment for breast cancer at the same clinic, and so they both went to River, and so she got to know them a bit. And she came along to the women's breakfast we did, and she'd come to about a second one, and she just started the experiment. She'd not yet received the Lord. And she just started the experiment with kind of talking to the Father because everyone around her was. And in the context of worship, she was anxious because what had happened was a few weeks before, she'd been at the clinic and she'd come out in tears, and this other lady from River had been sitting there and she'd talked to her about what had happened. And the cancer in the breast, which they were treating, had now moved to the liver and was not curable. It was treatable in the sense of manage it, but eventually it would get her. And so what they were suggesting is they would cut the tumours out just to keep the sizes down, so they would operate while they could. And so she was very shaken up by that. And so she was at this meeting and she just started to talk to the Lord about it. And as she started to talk to the Lord about it, she heard a voice come back into her head. No one taught her about these things, but the voice just said, it's going to be all right. Well, she was fearful about her operation on Wednesday. She had the operation that week on the Wednesday. So when this word came in, it will be all right, she just took great comfort from it. She told others around. She said, I felt God was saying it will be all right. She went in on the Wednesday, and they scanned her, and all the tumours are gone. Wow. We have a girl that she used to be our children's worker. She's just getting married now. She's not doing that now. But she was involved in a terrible car accident, side-on smash. She was sitting right where the car hit. It flipped the car she was in over twice. They thought she would die on the way to hospital. I won't tell you the whole story, it's a long story, because we managed to get down to the hospital and we saw some tiny little breakthroughs there, which are fantastic, in that what happened is all her bones realigned, so they didn't have to reopen her and pin her, which is one of the things we prayed as we went down to the hospital. So they just let things set naturally, and she was up in a wheelchair much quicker, but she was always with a stick, and they said she always would be. And she was there at one meeting, and it was an open worship time. And at the end of the meeting, I just felt prompted by the Lord to go over, and I put a hand on her. I had a picture, and I started to pray out the picture I saw. And she suddenly flew forwards and started to manifest something demonic. And I had some revelation. I started to pray over, and she vomited on the floor. And I was supposed to be closing the meeting. I realized I hadn't expected that to happen. So we prayed over her until there was a calm. And then I went. I asked somebody else to keep praying and ministering the Holy Spirit over. I went and closed the meeting. As I closed the meeting, the next thing we realized is she's running around the hall, leaping and jumping. She's had time, she had hospital appointment after hospital appointment where they say, I don't understand what's happened here. In the end, they were still telling her, you know, you'll have necrosis in the bones. And they scanned, you know, because of the disruption to the blood supply in her hips. And she went and they've looked for necrosis and can't find any, basically. These are the kind of the biggest stories. We have others like this, but just day by day. Well, see, one of the things we're finding is that God is good. You said it earlier, God is good all the time. But you know, what happens is we build up an expectation where somehow we've got to earn something. At the end of the day, that is a human fleshly religious system. Somehow we need to operate out of the sense of the goodness of God. In Hebrews it says that without faith it's impossible to please God, but then it goes on and it says this, because you can't come to him if you don't believe he exists, and that he answers and he rewards those who seek him. There's two things there. One, you believe that God is there. That's easy for most Christians. Second, that he rewards those who seek him says something about his character, doesn't it? Faith isn't just about the fact he's there. It's actually also something about his character. It really is coming with an expectation that God is good enough that he's going to do something back for you. He may be wiser than you and may answer it in a different way to the way you expect, but actually he is going to reward those that seek him. He's going to reward those that seek him. And so increasingly we are developing within the church a culture which expects to be able to walk in the Holy Spirit, expects to be able to hear God easily, expects that if we pray the goodness of God on someone, something will happen. Expects that. And so this, when I say there are healings every week, I'm not involved in them all by any means as the pastor. We hear story after story coming from all sorts of corners. I have the great privilege, obviously, you get the chance to pray for a lot of folks. And here's a simple equation. If you pray for a lot of folks, you will see people healed. The thing that I can absolutely guarantee you is if you don't pray for anybody, you won't see anyone healed. Okay? That's the simple factor. If you pray for people, you may or may not see them healed, but you keep praying for them and you will see some. I absolutely can guarantee, I will guarantee it. Because you are a child of God. And Lord, how much more does your Father in heaven desire to give good things to those that ask? You know, these are good things you're asking for your neighbours, for your friends. If you do those things, you keep doing it. See, sometimes there are reasons. Sometimes there are blockages. Sometimes the human psyche is complex. You read through Mark. I would encourage you to do it. Read the healing stories through Mark. It's not just the obvious ones where Jesus prays twice. Almost every story in Mark where we have the detail of how Jesus prayed, he asks something or he does something first. See, the human psyche is complex and there is a maturity that Jesus wants us to grow into to learn how to pray. Okay. So we may not always get it right. Jesus comes down the mountain one day and his disciples can't cure this boy. But Jesus does, because it's not because God doesn't want to. It's just they haven't yet learnt it. So the truth is, if you start praying for people, sometimes they may not get healed, but don't think that that's because God doesn't love. Actually, it's he wants you to grow into the maturity of a full son, a full heir, who understands like Jesus, but we do it by experience. We learn a little more. We learn when we need to say to people, actually, you need to have your sins forgiven first. We learn as we discover, do you actually want to be healed? I mean, it's an incredible question, but it's so real, because so many people find an identity in their sickness. You know, and you look and we find Jesus does these things. These are the maturity of it, but the simple level is God is good and wants to do good things for those who ask. So let's start doing it. What I want to do is I want to involve Dave, who I brought with us. Dave is our youth worker. And one of the things I'll just say is, when Jesus wanted to teach his disciples about the kingdom of God, he didn't do it from a book. He did it by taking them to experience something with him. Okay. Seek and you find, says Jesus. Knock and the door is opened. You don't have because you don't ask. And what I would really encourage is an absolute fundamental thing is sometimes if we want to push into these things, we have to go somewhere to see something that changes and peels back our brains. You know, I've now been to places where they have more healings and I have seen the most mind-peeling healings. I was at one place where there was a shriveled woman shriveled in a wheelchair with an oxygen mask. And in the worship, everyone was dancing. I was right next to her, and I kept thinking, I'm going to trip back on her. I really don't want to. And we all went and sat down as they started to pray around the room. Suddenly, I see this lady on the platform and someone carrying the wheelchair up to give testimony. It's the same lady. She's been in this wheelchair 17 years. Her muscles were wasted when I saw it. Now they're all bulky. Okay. And can I say, in my head, it felt like someone had got a potato peeler and was peeling my brain. Because I had no context for this suddenly, this wasted muscles being restored to fat muscles. Does that make sense? And yet here she was, and here is the nurse that bought her, saying, I've been with this lady. She's been sick for 19 years, and I've been with her 17 of those years. She's been in this wheelchair, and here she is, bulky. She's walked up on her own. You know, there is something, and so when Jesus wanted his disciple to step into more, he had to take them with them first. But then he says, now you go and do it. Okay. But, you know, sometimes we have to see it more than once. Think about the feeding of the 5,000. Feeding of the 4,000, just a couple of chapters later, Jesus says, so they're all hungry, what are we going to do? They don't instantly think, let's pray for more food. They do the same thing again. That's the way we are. When I first saw people healed, I was really excited. When I next saw sick people, I didn't think to myself, the Lord's going to heal them. I just went and kind of, how are you doing then? Are you all right? You know? And now I realize, actually, why not? Why miss the opportunity? Let's do it. Let's do it. But it took the disciples multiple occasions of seeing to really start having their brains changed. Okay? So we need to put ourselves in the place, recognizing that he will change us and transform us as we see more. So I want to give Dave the opportunity to come and speak, because Dave with our young folks are taking it out on the streets much more regularly than I am. So I want him to tell some stories and just give some good examples and share some of the principles you've learned, Dave.
Can everyone just say to the person next to them, God loves you. Could everyone say to the person next to them, God absolutely adores you. Could everyone say to the person next to them, God is obsessed with being in love with you. Amen. Amen. He is so good. Pete, when are we going to pray for the sick? We're going to do that in a bit. Okay. I've got a really bad pain in my left knee. Does anyone have something wrong with their left knee? If so, put your hand up. Okay. I've just got a bad knee. I need some prayer. That's fine. Yeah. Shall I just tell some stories of stuff that we've been seeing out on the street? I went out, can I just say that kind of we come here humbly, we're really just learning how to do this. This is kind of really the early stages of learning how to pray for the sick, and it's something that we're just learning as we go. But about a year or so ago, I was out on the streets in Bath, and me and my friend, we went to buy a big issue, and we started speaking to this lady, and we started to get that revelation of the love of God. That's why it's good to just declare it over one another. God loves people. God loves us. We are royalty because we are his kids, and all that kind of stuff. And as you begin to kind of declare that and live in that, you begin to get a fresh realization that actually, like, he loves to love people. He loves to bless people, and that is kind of physically, emotionally, spiritually, it's all aspects. And when you get full of that, you can't help but then begin to think differently. So anyway, we're getting this revelation of kind of the love of God, and we started, so we bought a big issue from this lady, and we got chatting to her, and I just felt like kind of a real compassion for her. And one of the things that I've learned is that a lot of the time when you get a compassion for someone, that is actually kind of a trigger for faith. That it's a trigger to then think, oh, actually, maybe I need to pray for someone, because Jesus always, he so often had compassion on the sick before he saw them healed. And we just began to get a real compassion over this lady. And we just said, hey, you know, this is going to sound really random. And, you know, I don't want to freak you out or anything, but is there anything we can pray for you for? And she was going, no, not really, I'm absolutely fine. And we went, well, any kind of sickness in your body, anything wrong with like that? And she goes, well, actually, you know, I've got really bad arthritis in my hand. Oh, and now you speak about it, I can't move my arm. I can't move my shoulder. She had a locked shoulder, and she couldn't move her arm above there. And so we just thought, okay, well, could we pray for you? And she's like, yeah, that's fine. And so we said, would you mind if we just put, like, you know, lay hands on your shoulder? Because I think it's good to do that. It's good to be really polite to people and to honor and love them. And we prayed, like, one of those prayers, sometimes, if you've ever prayed a prayer, and it just feels like there's no anointing on it at all, you know, it feels like it's hitting the ceiling and coming back down. And other prayers, you pray and you kind of think, you know, this one's going straight to heaven. We prayed one of those prayers that basically it felt like I was just talking to her. I was just talking to myself. I was like, yeah, God, I just thank you that you love her and that you died so that, you know, she could be healed. She's your princess. And we just ask that your healing power will come now. And that was it. And suddenly she goes, cool, thanks, how's it? And I go, do you want to test it out? That's a good thing to do. And she starts going, oh, there's no pain. There's no pain. And we're like, oh, there's no pain. We're like completely shocked, completely like, whoa, God is real. This isn't just some giant placebo effect. And then we go, how's your arm? And she starts going, oh my gosh, it's completely fine. She can move it. And she had full rotation after there. And we were just kind of freaking out going, oh, this is crazy. And the woman, she rings up her husband. She goes, honey, guess what's happened? You know, these two young people, they just prayed for me and now my arm's completely fine. And we were like going, yeah, it's because God loves you. Go and visit the church down the road and things like that. And that was just so encouraging, you know. It's so encouraging to minister kind of like the healing power of God. Like it says in I don't know which Corinthians it is, but it says that the natural mind can't understand the things of the spirit. So what do they need? They need things in our realm. And that's when healing evangelism, it comes into play. It's God loves you here. It's on a plate. You're healed. I can understand that. It's substance. We've been like kind of just trying to minister into the prophetic as well, because not everyone needs healing. And there's something about kind of having a yielded imagination to the Lord and just kind of being obedient to the prompting of him. My best friend Miles, he was running along training for the London Marathon in Hyde Park, actually. And as he ran past this lady on a bench, and he just felt like he needed to go back and say to her that God loves her. So he ran past, he thought, oh, it's just my imagination. And then he kind of got to this tree and was like, oh, you know, I want to push into these things. And sometimes to push into these things, you've got to just kind of be prepared just to go for it, even if it is wrong. And so he sits behind a tree and is just going, come on, come on, come on. Because part of it is about understanding how to seize moments. You know, a moment will open up to you and it's your choice whether or not you want to step into it or not. And he sees the moment and he goes up to this lady who's sitting on a bench and he goes, excuse me, this is going to sound really weird. I don't normally do this, but I just feel like I'm to tell you that God loves you. And she just goes, oh, what does that mean? So he kind of just sits down next to her and he goes, well, basically, which kind of unpacks the gospel, really. You know, God is real, and he just thinks you're a princess, and he just loves you. And whatever you're going through at the moment, he just wants to say that he's there. And this lady just breaks down in tears and starts sobbing and sobbing and sobbing. And my friend Miles, he's thinking, oh, no, like, what do I do now? I'm just like this woman's wailing next to me, and he's like, do I put my arm around her or what? And she kind of just kind of comes around, and he goes, yeah, okay, cool, well, you know, have a nice day. And that's it. It's as simple as that. You're just kind of, we are walking solutions to people's problems, you know? Everyone's got stuff going on with them. And we are carrying the answer to that. We are carrying the Holy Spirit in us. We are vessels, temples of the creator of the cosmos. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Shakabamba. What else happened? So ministering in the prophetic is really cool. I was out in Reading, which is the town next to our town, and one of the things I would advise in praying for the sick is to speak on people's level. And I think you just kind of, you just got to discern it, really. There's something about discerning it. If you meet an elderly lady, you're not going to go up to her and be really aggressive and be, hey, man, let me pray for you. Whereas if it was a group of young people, then it might be like that. Hey, do you want to see some power? Do you want to see, like God move or something like that? So this girl walks up to us, and she's asking for money. And basically, I didn't have any money. She was collecting change for a charity, and I didn't have any money. And in that moment, it just kind of, I was reminded of Peter, you know, silver and gold I have not, none, but take up your mat and walk. I said, no, sorry, we don't have any money, but we're offering spiritual readings and miracles. And what I was, in theory, like what I was saying to her kind of was, we're offering prophetic words and prayer for healing. But it was kind of, I just felt like that was what I should say in that moment. And that kind of opened up kind of an opportunity to speak to her. She was like, whoa, that sounds cool, man. I'm really up. What does that mean? And I basically said, well, what we do is we're Christians and we believe in God and we just hear from God and we'll just get a word for you. And she immediately begins to switch off, because what happened was she was a backslidden Christian who'd been really hurt by church. So if we had come in saying, hi, we're Christians, can we please pray for you? You know, we might not have kind of got in there. And she's like, yeah, I'm kind of up for it. And then she just said outright, she went, if you can hear from God, what's my name? Like that. And I'm like, oh, Shabba, what am I going to do? Like that. And I just say this, I just went, well, I've had the name Emily running through my head all day. And she goes, huh? How do you know? And I'm like, what are you talking about? And she goes, that's my name, Emily. And I'm like, that's your name, Emily? That's crazy. And like, suddenly, God's kind of invaded, you know? Suddenly you've got kind of an ability just to speak to a stranger in the street just about how God loves them. Because he's shown it by communicating something supernaturally that I would never have known. It's cool. I mean, some people that I know are like kind of really walking in it. We went out in Dudley with some guys, and there was these little kids who we went with, and they would just go up to people in the bank queue and in Pizza Hut and be, excuse me, we're doing this, and this is what they say. They go, excuse me, we're doing this thing where we're trying to learn to hear from God. Could we have a go at getting a word from God for you? And sometimes they would get kind of rebuked and just, you know, oh, no, it's cool. But once you push through that, once you've had kind of a couple of, you know, no, it's okay, and people getting on with their own stuff, you always get like at least one or two encounters with people where you just really get to just love them and just minister to the love of God to them. And I was out with these kids, and they would just give prophetic words to people, sometimes really generic stuff, but they were pulling out the gold from people. And six people became Christians that day on the street. And I was just blown away. I was going, man, this is easy. It really is easy. Kind of one of the things I'd like to say is that actually, in order to minister in power, you just need courage. You just need courage. So one of the things is probably just getting full of the Holy Spirit, spending time just praying for one another, worship. Worship is so key to hosting the presence of God. Chris is talking about kind of us being a church, which when we host the presence of God, there's something about worship which is step one for your spirit engaging with God's spirit. Does that make sense? You know, you feel it, you begin to just kind of get drawn into it. Worship is so key. Chris's son and two guys from my youth group, we were up in Rugby. And they went out on the street just while we were in lunch. And one of the guys called Tay, one of the guys called Ryan, the other guy's called Jonathan. And there was a blind guy asking for money. And young people, there's something about young people. I don't know if you have young people here, but young people, like, they are a fire. They can have a fire which needs to be harnessed. And once harnessed, it's just unbelievable. You know, young people, like, they want something to die for, you know. A lot of young people, they get really mad about kind of if stuff's fair or not, you know. Have you ever noticed that? It's usually very unbalanced, but they're really passionate. They want something to be passionate about. So it's good because it means they can be fearless at times. Anyway, they go up to this blind guy on the street and they go, hey, man, can we pray for you? And I'm like, well, like, when they came and told me the story, I just don't have the kind of the courage for these things. But they just did it in their innocence. Hey, can we pray for you? And they're like, he's like, yeah, go for it. So they pray for this blind guy, and they say, so what can you see? Can you start to see anything? And he go, and they go, yeah, I can kind of start to see. I can start to see kind of like people as trees, and I can kind of see like a blurredness. And they go, okay, cool. God loves you. Have a nice day, you know. And they didn't kind of think to kind of to continue praying and to think, okay, Holy Spirit's on the move. Let's kind of pray more. But there's a generation rising up. I just want to say there's a generation rising up who are taking hold of the promises of God. All of creation is groaning for the sons and daughters to be revealed. They're taking hold of the mantles that have gone before. You know, those of Wesley, those of Wigglesworth. People who have walked our nation and walked in irrefutable signs and wonders, and that it's been laid down by the church. There's a generation now who are rising up with fire in their eyes and are thinking, you know what? I just want to go for this. I don't care if I fail. I don't care if I look stupid. I don't care if people think that, you know, I'm an idiot. I just want to have a go. I just want to see something, you know? I just want to live out like a Christianity that makes sense. Like, with the way I read the Bible, you know? The Bible is crazy when you read it. Like, if we believed the Bible, if we saw kind of what happened in the Bible nowadays, we'd see a very different church. You know, tight groups of people walking through seas, people running faster than cars. It's crazy. We had another guy who we went out on the street, and it's something about big issue people. Maybe just because they're just open to stopping with people and chatting on the street. But the guy called Oliver, he just offered to pray for a big issue lady, and she had something wrong with her hand again, and her arm was just completely healed. And guys, I don't really know what to say other than it's easy. It really is easy. All you need is courage, really. And I think another bit of advice would be, I think there's a reason Jesus sent the disciples out in twos, because when you're with someone else and you're going with intent, like, and you see someone with a crutch and then they're with you, you're like, oh man, should we pray for them? Shall we pray for them? Because someone else is there and you know you're going out to pray for the sick, you can't look like you're failing. You can't look uncool. So you kind of like, oh yeah, I'm going to go for it. And like, you're well scared. But if you're by yourself, you know, it's okay to chicken out. Do you know what I mean? Like, you can see something, you'd be like, no, it's not right. It's not right. I'm not really feeling it. You know, they're busy. I think another thing we've seen is a really key thing, is being led by the Holy Spirit, going out beforehand and actually going, kind of knowing that the Holy Spirit wants to meet people. So I'll give you an example. We learned this thing from some guys over in the States, from a guy called Bill Johnson's church, which is called treasure hunting. And this is one of the ways they do evangelism, and it's just one of the ways that we're now learning to do evangelism. And it doesn't always work because we're learning, but I guess, you know, practice makes perfect. And what it is, it's saying, like, out there is hidden treasure. Out there are kind of is hidden treasure that God wants us to find, you know. And what you do beforehand, and we've done this, and we've kind of seen some really, really interesting stuff happen, amazing stuff actually, is it's really simple. You just get full of the Holy Spirit. You have a little Holy Spirit time in worship. And then what you do is you go, okay, Holy Spirit, I want you to speak to us and help us write a treasure map to the hidden treasure, basically people. And what we'll do is we'll write down everything that pops into our head within like a space of a minute. And because, you know, you have sometimes have this thing, oh, is it our imagination or is it God? That kind of thing. We're just kind of trusting that in that moment, like, the Holy Spirit will just come and just use our imagination, you know, because that's what he created it for, to speak to us. And so you write random stuff down. So you write things like, one girl in, we did this about a year ago when we were just kind of learning how to do it. And this one always sticks out to me. One girl in our youth group who'd never kind of like done any kind of evangelism, was really shy. She wrote down blue, hairdresser, and Nancy. And that was it. And we were in a town that we'd never been to. And we were just walking around. And what you do then is you find stuff. You find that the Holy Spirit begins to lead you to things that match up to the treasure map. So she was walking around. And after about 40 minutes, she went down this back alley. And she came across a hairdresser's, which entire branding, the windows were blue and the writings were blue. It was all blue. So she's like, hang on a second, hairdresser, blue. She walks into the door, through the door, and the lady comes up to you. She goes, hi, I'm Nancy. How can I help? And she's like, oh, my goodness. And suddenly she's gone from this really shy person to someone who knows that God wants to use to impact the situation. Suddenly she's filled with boldness, and she's just like, well, hi, Nancy. Basically, I'm a Christian, and God has led me to you today. This is my treasure map, and this is you. Can I please pray for you? And I think, I can't really remember the rest of the story. I think she was like, yeah, yeah, cool. And she just prayed for this lady in the shop, you know, just bless you, you know, have a nice life, just God loves you. And that's just amazing, isn't it? That's fantastic. And it's easy, because when you see that God is already out there, he's already wooing people to himself, all you have to do is participate in it, and things happen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.